Alright guys, here we are for the Raw review for October the 1st, 2012. We have ourselves a pretty bland show, I guess you could say, this week. That's my opinion. You know, everybody's always got a mixed view of Raw. But as far as I'm concerned, this show was not what I'd call amazing in any way, shape, or form. However, the opening segment was pretty good. We had Paul Heyman and CM Punk coming to the ring. Punk pretty much saying this whole Cena match isn't even happening, and that Cena needs to learn respect, that he can't even say anything straight to his face, because he doesn't respect him and all that. Paul Heyman gets on the mic, says, AJ, we should be gone as the general manager, and that he should be the replacement because of AJ's physical confrontation with him last week, as well as her physical confrontation with Vicky Guerrero, which is shown later, because Vicky and Dolph come out, and Vicky says she wants to share the power with Heyman, and they can both run Monday Night Raw. And then AJ comes out and says that she's on probation, but she's still the general manager. And then she's interrupted by Daniel Bryan, who starts yelling about how he's the tag team champions, and that AJ's upset because she isn't with him anymore, and because he's a great-looking guy and all that. I have a great beard and all that. So that part was funny. Kane ends up coming out and saying he's the tag team champions. You know, he was like, oh, Daniel Bryan's right about all this, except for one thing. So they start arguing over that. And then basically, Punk and Dolph Ziggler are arguing. Punk's like, I am the WWE champion. Ziggler's like, I am the Money in the Bank. It was pretty funny. And then AJ just screams, like, really loudly, and then says that we're having a tag team main event match with Ziggler and Punk versus Team Hell No. And it was 20 minutes, though. This was a long promo. I don't think it needed to quite be 20 minutes. So that seems to be the generic beginning for Monday Night Raw. It really almost always seems to start with like a 15 to 20 minute promo segment, and that's getting kind of boring. But to have a 20 minute promo like this wasn't as bad, because the promo was actually pretty damn good. So we had a tag match to open up the card for matches. We had 9 again. Very, very like large for matches again, as Raw has been lately. But the fact of the matter is that most of these matches are really short and not even that good. But this first match was very good. It was Rey and Sin Cara versus Primo and Epico in the tag tournament. Rey and Sin Cara defeat Primo and Epico, with PTP on the stage like applauding afterwards. I'm not really sure why they even were out there if they didn't do anything and that stopped this match in any way, shape, or form. But Rey and Sin Cara go over, as they should. Some very impressive stuff from them. I love their new masks. It's pretty cool. Good match. I really enjoyed this, and I love the fact that they're having a tag title tournament to determine who will face Team Hell No at Hell in a Cell. I love that they're really making this tag team division feel good, and I cannot praise WWE enough for that reason. I think it is awesome that they're making the tag division feel important again. I just love it. After this, we had Antonio Cesaro basically squash Brodus Clay. Now, I will say, it was very impressive when Antonio Cesaro lifted Brodus Clay for his finisher and actually held him up for a few seconds. I don't get it. Brodus Clay has basically been used, you know, as a guy that squashes other people, and then he gets squashed that easily. He really hasn't lost. How many matches has Brodus Clay lost? A couple. And he lost it this match in like 90 seconds, which is very surprising. I guess they're really, really high on Cesaro and really high on pushing him. And it's right. Your U.S. champion should be beating Brodus Clay, but not in 90 seconds necessarily. But whatever. Cesaro, I like him. I like the in-ring ability of Cesaro. I like Cesaro as an overall, but I'm not really a huge fan of the way this character is being presented. That's just my opinion. We get a backstage segment to follow this up with Caitlyn and AJ. AJ basically, you know, laughing and acting crazy. There's still that little bit of craziness to AJ. It's kind of interesting. Anyway, all I was happy about was seeing Caitlyn. That's all I got to say about that segment. We had another match to follow this with, which was The Miz defeating Zack Ryder in very, very short order. Again, you're like, okay. He beat him so quickly that it was like, alright, so The Miz gets squashed by Ryback 1 week, and then they make up for it. They compensate, do the flip side where Miz squashes someone else. And then we move on to the Sheamus Big Show debate, which was a part of our Raw Active tonight, where you could hashtag Sheamus Show, and you could ask questions via Twitter or Tout. There were only two questions addressed. Booker T was out there to like be the guy that was with the debate. This is probably all coming back to the whole, you know, election thing that's going on, obviously. The only really funny part about this segment that I thought was hilarious was Big Show. Actually, he was very funny, and his podium ended up collapsing. He leaned on, he's like, I leaned on my podium and it collapsed. It was really funny, because that just happened out of nowhere. But outside of that, like, really, this segment, not really a whole lot to write home about. And I remember at one point actually saying that I really think that Sheamus just isn't that great of a babyface, to be completely honest. He's not terrible. I'm not saying he's terrible. It's just he's kind of just boring. It's really not that exciting to me. But the debate was okay. It just ended up with a stare down, and that was it. No physicality whatsoever. But we move on. That was about the one-hour main event to Ryback defeating Tensai, and everybody's going to be talking about how this match, how Ryback tried to lift Tensai twice, and both times it was failed terribly. Now, many are blaming Tensai right off the bat and saying that Tensai didn't jump into the move enough. You know, to be honest with you, I really don't know who to place the blame on, but it looked very, very sloppy. It was terrible. The first time they tried to cover it over and say that Tensai it was reversing it, and then the second time, there's no way to cover that over. Ryback ends up winning off of a clothesline, a very, very quick match, squash. Tensai is nothing, and here's my thing, and there's really one thing I want to talk about with Ryback here, and that's the simple fact that Ryback is being pretty much used as a guy that is going to be a big deal. You know, he's facing off with CM Punk, and then on the same show, he's squashing Tensai. It's like, why even put him in a match with Tensai if you're going to have him come face-to-face with CM Punk later on in the night, and they did that, so I'll get to that later, though. This match was awful, though. We had a Divas match to follow where Eve defeats Beth Phoenix, and that's all I have to say. It's bullshit. It was not a very good match either. Wade Barrett is backstage saying that AJ is doing a terrible job, needs to get her relationships and work separated. Good little promo from Barrett. Kind of a little bit random, but at least it got him on Raw. I'm happy with that. And then we get the segment with Encore. It was Heath Slater versus Santino, but Drew and Jinder were at ringside, and they ended up causing a disqualification when Santino was pretty much going for the win. And then I thought it was pretty awesome. I really thought it was cool, a cool ending, and I like the little stable they got going on with Encore. I think it's actually pretty cool. But again, it gets McIntyre on TV, and that is what, to me, is the biggest thing for me, because I'm a huge McIntyre fan. But it also, you know, gives Slater and Jinder Mahal something to do, besides just being squashed all like every once in a while. I mean, they're not on TV for like a month and a half, and then they get squashed. At least Slater was making TV almost every week. But now you can have these guys actually maybe do a little something, make a little bit of a splash, you know, have a couple of them go for the tag belts or something. I don't know. Do something with them, for Christ's sake. I think this little stable with Encore, I think it could be something good, especially on SmackDown. After this, okay, now this was the highlight of the night. No doubt about it. We had Damian Sandow versus Sheamus, because earlier on in the night, Damian and Cody Rhodes, the Rhodes Scholars, they were talking about how improper Sheamus was and all that. And so they end up with a match, Sandow, Sheamus. Now, this match was the proving ground, in my opinion, for why I believe that Damian Sandow is the future of the WWE and why he's not only a future main eventer, but a world champion of that level. He was fan-fucking-tastic in this match. This completely opened up a lot of people's eyes. I can already guarantee that. This really made it clear that Damian Sandow is one of the most talented guys WWE has right now. It was an amazing matchup that went about 15 minutes. They just let these guys go, because I'll tell you, and this is credit to Sheamus as well. This was a very well-worked match. Great stuff. Damian Sandow really can hold his own. My God, can he hold his own. And Sheamus ends up winning with a double brogue when Cody came into the ring to try to, like, help Sandow and ends up being a double bro kick. It didn't really look very good, but still, regardless, the match was awesome. This was the match of the night, and also the highlight is the fact that Damian Sandow is being used in such a high manner, and he looked amazing in this match. I mean, kicking out, and getting a lot of offense, and on the world heavyweight champion. I don't care who you are, I don't care how little those belts seem to mean nowadays, it's still a big deal when you got a guy like a Sandow who's fairly, you know, new in your company, hitting, getting a lot of offense in on your world champion. I think it's awesome. I think it's the right move, and you're pushing Sandow quickly, but more gradually than a Ryback, and you're having him actually go out there and wrestle a 15-minute match, and if you ask me, he has what it takes to really get to the main event. I love his character, I love the gimmick, I love the ability. He has everything it takes. He's the total package, in my opinion. I see so much in Sandow, not even funny. So that was my appreciation, my highlight of the night. I don't even know where the fuck that came from. Anyway, we move on. Oh, it came from the next segment, which was the JR appreciation, which didn't even happen at all because CM Punk and Paul Heyman interrupted right after JR got called to the ring. Pretty much what we get out of this is CM Punk claiming that, you know, JR needs to call him the best in the world and all that, and he says, oh, we got something in common, we're both the best at what we do. JR calls him, ah, you've been a jackass on TV the last few weeks, that's all I know. And then Punk says, wow, you show me just as little respect as they do, and they don't even know the first thing about respect. JR pretty much says that all the greats over the years, because he pretty much poked at Stone Cold Steve Austin, and here I am like, Stone Cold? Could it be Stone Cold? On the 316th day of CM Punk's reign, that would be the coolest thing of all time, to see Stone Cold come out and say, I'm coming for your title, you son of a bitch, and that's the bottom line. Just saying. That would be amazing. Come on. But anyway, pretty much what JR says is, yeah, so what? I'll call Stone Cold and The Undertaker and Shawn Michaels, all these guys, all these great matches I've called over the years. They earn the distinction of being called the best in the world. You haven't. You just go around demanding it. You know, they didn't demand it. They just earned it. And he says, you know what? I'll be the first guy in line to call you the best in the world if you can accept John Cena's challenge for Hell in a Cell and go in there, kick his ass, and win and retain your belt. You know, and pretty much Punk just continues to show disrespect to JR by stomping on his hat and, you know, sliding it, kicking it out of the ring. And so then pretty much he tells JR to walk away, get out of here, and then so JR does, because obviously Punk was probably going to attack him if he didn't. And as he starts to walk away, we hear Ryback's music, and Ryback comes out, faces off with Punk, Punk walks away. So as far as I'm concerned, what we get out of that is Ryback really is probably going to be used in more of a main event type of picture, maybe. It's either that or Punk recruited Ryback, and it looks like Ryback's coming for Punk, but in reality, they're actually going to team up, and Ryback can be like a muscle for Punk. It really wouldn't be that bad, kind of how like they had Mason Ryan teaming with Punk back in 2011. But either way, I see Ryback feuding with Punk, if anything. I think it would be good to have him as a face. But in the same note, I have to say that I don't think it's good that Ryback is already getting pushed to the main event that quickly, especially when he's squashing guys on shows still. He's not ready for the main event level. They have not built him to that level yet. So to follow this, we had Del Rio defeat Kingston in an alright match via armbar. Okay. And then the main event was Team Hell No defeating CM Punk and Dolph Ziggler. AJ was the special guest referee for this match. It was an alright match. Didn't go all that long. Basically, once both managers got ejected, Heyman and Vicky, Ziggler went to chase down Vicky, and Punk was distracted, got chokeslammed, and got pinned. And then the show ends with Daniel Bryan and Kane yelling, I am the tag team champions, back and forth at each other. So so that's the show. So for an overall, I'm thinking about a C. I'm not that easy on shows usually, so I'm just gonna be fucking honest. I'm gonna give it a C minus here. I really wasn't that huge of a fan of this Raw. Now some may say Raw was real good, and I'm not gonna say you're wrong. I thought the opening segment was okay, just a little long. A lot of squash matches tonight. I mean, we had it. Then again, you had highlights like Sandow versus Sheamus, and a little more for Encore. That's not bad. But I mean, outside of that, there was a lot of squash, a lot of filler, and a lot of not much time at all spent building up to Hell in a Cell at all, which is only a few weeks away. I'm just saying. So I was not fully satisfied with tonight's Raw. I'm just going to give it a C- and say it was definitely below average. Let's just put it at that. I wasn't that happy with it. So let me know what you guys thought about Raw in the comments section below. Also, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe for more to come. Thanks as always for watching. Follow me on